So welcome everybody. My name is Lynette Young. I am founder and curator, fancy title, of Women of Google Plus, and I own my own technology social media firm called Purple Stripe Productions. Every Monday night, 9 o'clock Eastern Time, I do a show based for women of Google Plus or professional women that use Google Plus, but honestly, everybody seems to like the content we have. So tonight I found an amazing woman and author. She's brilliant, but I'm going to let Adrienne introduce herself, and then I'm going to tell you how I found her and how I, not begged, but how I kind of coerced her to come in and do a live hangout with us. So Adrienne, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. I am Adrienne Graham. First and foremost, a mom. I always like to say that before I go to the professional field. I run two companies. One, I'm on the verge of kind of phasing out. It's a recruitment consulting firm, and I work with venture capital funded startup companies and portfolio companies doing recruitment for executive and tech talent. But my passion and my baby, which I've been growing over the last couple of years, is Empower Me Corporation. And I like to tell people it's a media, publishing, and educational company. And by that I mean it's about growth strategies, helping people grow in any economy, whether it's their business or their career, and just kind of getting them out of that rut or stuck mode and helping them to actually take control and grow, regardless of who's in the administration, what's going on in the government, what's going on around, you know, the job market. But that's pretty much what it is in a nutshell. We have a media property, our radio show, Views from the Top, and we also have a magazine, Empower Me Magazine. And my newest baby is Empower Me Institute, where we teach people the art of entrepreneurship in small business management.
I love it. So the reason how I found Adrienne is actually only like 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. Shame on me. But I saw an article that you had posted because you're a contributor to Forbes.com.
Yes.
And I saw an article that you had posted. See, and I have my notes on my screen. About basically what I call and what I've referenced for a couple years now is the no free lunch. Mm-hmm. And the title of your article was "No, You Can't Pick My Brain, It Costs Too Much." And the date of the article was actually March 28th of 2011. Mm-hmm. And I read it, and honestly, when I read it, I didn't look at the date, and I was like, it's relevant. Mm-hmm. all of the time. Can you tell me a little bit about what the catalyst for writing that post was, and then we'll go into how that turned into a book.
Okay. Well, let me clarify. I'm a former contributor.
Okay, former contributor.
Yeah, I just wrapped up in engagements with them. I'll be writing for Harvard Business Review now, which is next step on the brand. What happened was back in March, I was sitting in my bed with my laptop, and I don't know, many of you viewers probably know Sarah Evans out in Illinois, but she had posted a Facebook comment, and she says, "You know what? I'm really tired of people picking my brain. You know, what do you think about that?" And it was flooded. I mean, her whole timeline was flooded up with comments about that. And at that particular time, I had enough of people coming to me. And it sounds kind of narcissistic because I do a radio show, I do newsletters, I do a blog, I give advice on Twitter. I mean, it's phenomenal, and I love my followers and readers and all of that. But it felt to me that the people that I was targeting are the people that come back as repeat offenders. And it's like they want to pull every piece of knowledge you have, every drop of blood out of your body. And I'm like, okay, I do all of this. What more do they want from me? And I said, for now, I'm just going to tell people, just go to Google if you want any more information. And I started getting a reputation of, oh, Adrienne will answer that question. Oh, if whatever it is, Adrienne will do it. And I don't mind helping, but, you know, this is how I pay my bills. This is how I put my son through college. So that post kind of sparked something in me. I said, you know what? Yeah, I'm tired of this. And I just banged out the post. I didn't post it right away because I said, well, maybe I'm a little too harsh. Let me go out for a little bit, come back. Came back, looked at it, made a couple of spelling edits. I said, you know what? I'm not changing a word because it is exactly how I feel, and I believe in being authentic. Hit push, you know, submit, and went about my business. In about 3 days, I got flooded, bombarded with email and thank you. Oh, my God, it's what I've been thinking. So, you know, we kind of rode that for a while. And Funny enough, in January 2nd, the day before I started to come back from work after my hiatus, I said, you know what, I have a direction, I have my other book out, 2012 is going to be great. January 3rd, I woke up to a flood of email and tweets and messages saying, I love your Forbes article. And I'm like, what Forbes article? I haven't written for them since the summer, and we ended our relationship in November, so what are they talking about? So I had to do some digging, and I looked, and I said, oh, my God, the article took on a life of its own. Somebody resurrected it. The book was nowhere near completed. I had my outline, maybe 3 chapters done, and I said, you know what? It's still a relevant topic. People are still kind of trying to struggle with how to draw that line and not be used for their knowledge. And ever since then, I've been on a tear trying to get it done, answering questions, comments, and all of that stuff. And the book will be ready on the 23rd.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, and I probably caught it in that long tail of how it picks back up. You know, it'd be interesting to be able to see where it sparked up again. But I had seen it pass on Google+ and read it. And like I said, it had resonated with me because it's that, you know, $30,000 lunch, free lunch or whatever, that a lot of people that are, they sell their brain, honestly. They have that problem. And when I first reposted your article on my Google+ stream, I had, you know, and you saw too, because I tagged your name and you were like, oh, hey, thank you. All of a sudden, this whole nother, you know, leg of a conversation started up. That I had similar responses in the thread on Google+ that I had experienced bits and pieces over the past couple of years, that people that it had happened to, it resonated very deeply with. And people that it maybe hadn't happened to, or for whatever different circumstances, kind of looked at it and said, oh, well, that's kind of snobbish. Like, you're not going to help anybody. And I don't think it's – and you had explained it. It's the repeat offenders. Yeah. And I know for me, it's the people that come up to me and want my time, you know, and basically I'm self-employed just like you are, and, you know, we own our own businesses. My time is my money. And if I'm spending my time with someone else, it's time that I can't bill or work on something that will produce money for me.
Right.
Sit with someone for an hour, 2 hours, answer emails, help them along, and before I know it, it's a very targeted information or very targeted knowledge that they're looking for. And when they do that and they turn around and they make money from the help that I've given them, that's when I started realizing, and for me it was about 2009 that I had gotten burned a couple times like that, and I really got to be a tough cookie about that because I was very resentful that people were not only picking my brain for free, they didn't seem to me that they knew the value, the monetary value of that, even though they turned around and turned it into money for themselves. And I think that that was the most difficult part. I'm sure that you probably do a lot of the same things. You write a lot. You help people out in some capacities. I would consider it volunteering. You know, you're compiling information and putting it online for others to take and turn into knowledge for themselves. But there comes a time when it crosses that line. So
it does. It does. And especially, and I'll give an example, in recruiting. I've been doing it for 19 years. I'm pretty well known in the recruiting circles, and I bring a lot to the table. I implemented a lot of the internet stuff before it was the in thing to do. I've been a long study of technology, and I bring that to the table. And I will get Fortune 100 company recruiters who will email me and say something like, I need to recruit from diversity sites. Could you give me a list of the best sites? Can you tell me how do you make your strategy so that you can communicate? And I'm like, okay, we can set a consultation. No. I only have about 2 questions. And I'm like, no. I bill for that. You know, and they get upset. And that's just one example. There's many examples, but it's, you know, everybody wants to say, well, internet is free. Information is free. Yeah, it is. Very much. Implementation of said information is not free. And that's my new tagline for 2012.
See, reading your article, and then I was like, she's writing a book on this. Great. I'm going to actually have some tangible tools and tactics that, like, maybe you're going to give me phrases that I could say to people because sometimes I'm not gutsy enough to say no, you know? I kind of came up with the idea that through your post and the information that you'd put out on that topic, I kind of came up with the idea and solidified that information is easy to find online. Everybody's like, it's free on the internet. Information is free on the internet. The knowledge is not.
Right.
And that's when you take the information and you do something tangible with it that applies to a very specific circumstance, then it becomes knowledge.
Absolutely.
And that's what the difference is here. You know, I'll go places and I'll talk or I'll volunteer for things, and you do the same. You write, you're offering so much knowledge or information. See, I'm still confusing it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, to turn it into a very applied set of resources, it takes time, it takes your expertise, and it takes money, unfortunately, for them. But, you know.
I mean, it's, and people have to respect that, because I tell people all the time, if you went to your dentist and you know you needed a root canal, you wouldn't say, okay, work on half the tooth and then tell me how to fix the rest of it. You wouldn't do that. You know, I say some of these crazy things in the book too. But
that would be awesome.
Sometimes you have to drive the point home to people so that they understand. And when I get a little more graphic like that and give them specific examples, the best one, I think I put it in the article, was, you know, let's say your boss came up to you and said, you know what, Sally, that stuff that you do, we can get that on the internet for free. So we're not going to pay you for that time to do that. We don't want to pay you. You would be having all kind of pitchforks and torches and trying to burn the place down. Why do you do the same thing to consultants? Consultants may not work with their hands. They work with their brains. It's the same thing, and you have to respect that, and a lot of people don't.
And I do see that. I see, you know, friends of mine that are, say, possibly graphic designers, where they have a tangible product when they're done that they'll get paid for. But even in that instance, I've seen, you know, too many friends get burned. Well, they'll, you know, work with a client and they'll come up with, say, three options, you know, whatever they were contracted for. And the client decides, well, I don't like any of them, so I don't want to pay you at all because I didn't actually implement it. You're paying for the expertise, not always necessarily the end product as well, too.
Yeah.
I do some coaching with mostly professional women on this, too, and it's like, I can bring you along the journey, but I can't guarantee what you're going to do at the end. I can't guarantee you're going to make a dollar kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing. I would not expect any of my clients in that capacity at the end to say, well, I failed miserably in my endeavor, so I'm not going to pay you either, Lynette. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't work like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I find works for me is I have a program called Next Level Business Strategies, and I have a big old disclaimer. There's a link on my site that says legal claims, legal disclaimer, or whatever it is, legal stuff, that's what it is. Mm-hmm. And it says bright as day, you know, with any consulting or coaching or whatever, it's what you do with the knowledge that determines your success. I can't say that Tom will have the same success as Bobby, or Bobby the same as Diane, or whatever. You have to put your time and your effort into it, and you can't expect me to say, okay, let me write this blueprint for you. You do this, 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 and this, and here you go. No, that's not how it works. That's not how consulting works. That's not how coaching works. Yeah. And a lot of people just want that easy microwave solution.
Yeah. I don't remember, so I'm going to say this, but I can't quote the source. I'll have to Google it and see where to find it. But I remember about a year or two ago, I had seen an article pass by that had a recently graduated student from college try to sue the university because he couldn't get a job and he wanted all his money back for his tuition. And I'm like, that's kind of the same thing. like, I know the economy stinks. Let's take that out of the equation. Like, you know, if you can't apply what you've learned, then that's the way it goes. But that doesn't make the knowledge any less valuable.
Right.
So your idea to turn this into a book, so you write the article, and it's on fire last year, early when you first published it. Your idea to write a book was back then, because obviously you didn't decide 3 weeks ago to write a book when the article picked back up again.
Right.
Tell me how that idea kind of came about.
Well, the idea came about because, much like right now, how people are still commenting and asking questions, I said, you know what, let me just do a purge. Let me just put all the tools and techniques, my witty comebacks and things, let me put it all into a book. I also use real stories. I keep the names private unless they say I have permission, but real stories of other people, of things, instances that they've gone through with brain picking and how they handled it, as well as some of my own. And they're They're funny. You're going to laugh through this book. But I figured it would be a learning tool for people who maybe were a little shy or felt, you know, well, I'm only 3-4 years in the game. I don't have a right to tell people no. No, it doesn't matter if you are 1 year out the gate or you're a 20-year veteran. Your knowledge is your knowledge. That is how you make your money. And I figured that this book would help give people the confidence to do that. Well, other projects kind of took precedence over that, had the outline, had the first maybe 3 chapters done, and said, okay, yeah, and had the plan really over the holiday to finish out the book because I shut down my operations. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I needed a break. I didn't feel like writing or doing anything. And January 2nd, I mapped out my week and said, this is what we're going to do. You know, my other book, Get Recruited, is we're about to go on the road show for that. I said, okay, and then that's when they tell you, God, your plans are what God laughs at and tells you, hey, look at what I really have for you. So I had to jump back on the book. I went back in and kind of re-edited the beginning chapters to make it more current and finish out the book so that I could have it available the end of this month. So I've been kind of in seclusion right now.
Well, I'm glad that you popped out for a little while and joined us today.
Me too.
You know, I have to say, I was really excited that you're putting it on a Kindle as well.
Yeah. That's what I had planned to do. Actually, this book was not supposed to come out until June. That's what I figured, that would give me enough cushion to work with the one that I already have out. But my publicist said I could do it, juggle both books in tandem. But I originally said, you know what, I want to do this only on Kindle. And then I started getting the, not everybody has a Kindle. Not everybody wants to read on their phone. So I made the commitment to make it into a paperback as well. But Kindle's going to be the first version of it to come out a week before the paperback.
Right. I love that. I was excited about it. I am just getting into efficiently reading books on a Kindle. I have an iPad, so I run the Kindle app on there.
Mm-hmm.
It took me a little while because I like the dead trees. but the Kindle, you know what I have to say, the best benefit for a Kindle for a business book like yours is I can put annotations in it and share it. And, you know, and it makes it a lot easier to go back and reference all of the great pieces that I found in the book later. So I'm excited, especially for your book, to be on Kindle. I'll still get the dead tree version because I kind of still like those too, but having them digitally I think is a really good idea. It's the way everything's going now, and it's very easy. Obviously, I'm glad that it's out first because that's how I'll grab it.
It's a physical book, and this is just, I'm a new author. My first book only came out in 2009, and sometimes it's weird for me to hear myself say I'm an author because I've never intended to write books, but I like the physical product. I mean, for all intents and purposes, when I go to church, I take my iPad with me. That's how I'm reading. That's, you know, I'm like the only one in church with the iPad. When I'm traveling, I like to bring my iPad. I love books, but sometimes it's not feasible for me to carry them with me. So the Kindle is the next best thing, and my iPad is just phenomenal. So,
really, really good idea. So actually, I'm going to kind of go back to your splash page for your book, and I wanted to bring up a couple points to see if you could comment on them.
Okay.
You talk a lot about some of the things that you're going to show us in the book. One of the things that caught my eye, the first and foremost, is your first bullet point that says position yourself as a respected expert. Mm-hmm. Now, this was some of the feedback and the Slack that I have gotten in real life after I publicized the post. You know, people had emailed separately or commented, you know, privately, not in public, or conversations I've had over the past couple of years that they want to freely give away information because I guess they are on that ladder up, I guess. And I don't really like to phrase it that way because I don't mean it to be derogatory in any means, but a lot of people are not in the position that they're constantly getting asked for, you know, free information for, you know, can I come out, can I take you out for lunch, can I take you out for coffee, I'd like to talk to you, I'd like to ask you a couple questions.
Mm-hmm.
For most professionals, they would probably be flattered that it would be, you know, that someone found their information or what they know so valuable. I got caught into that myself, too, a time ago. Mm-hmm. So to kind of come out boldly and say, you know, no, I'm not going to do it. You can't pick my brain. There's, you know, money involved. Seems very cold.
Mm-hmm.
And to be completely honest, as a woman, it felt very anti-nurturing, helpful. I'm not supposed to be that way. I'm supposed to help people.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a difference between helping people and not being able to, you know, pay your mortgage. So,
right.
I was just wondering, like, your take on that, how you've kind of, have you given, like, a helpful roadmap or anything to try to have these people position themselves as an expert where people would think twice before asking for that free information or the free help?
Absolutely, yes. Now, just to kind of clarify again, I do help people. And a lot of people don't know this. With some of my programs that I do, I gift them to people. I'm very aware of what's going on around me on Twitter, Facebook, wherever. And I pay attention to people and what they're talking about. And people don't know because I don't do it publicly or say it publicly. This is the first time I'm saying it. I gift a lot of stuff to people because it's who I am. You know, the writing and the show and all that also comes hand in hand with that. But there is a point where you have to say, okay, this I'll give away for free. From here on, we have to charge. And you have to make sure that people are okay with that. I think if you draw the line in the very beginning and say, you know what, I'm here to lend an ear. You want to run a problem past me, that's fine. But when it gets to a point where they want you to draw out a blueprint for them or do their job for them, no, you can't. And that's not being unnurturing. It's not being mean. It's self-preservation. That's the way I feel and the way I look at it. I've had people who wanted me to do salary comps, draw out a recruiting strategy, a six-month forecast. No, that costs money. That's not something that you can, you know, just go on the web and pick that up. I have to sit down and really do work on that, and I'm not going to do that for free. With a lot of the newer people or newer consultants, like you said, they feel like, you know, I have to give this information. There's a way to do it where you can still share your knowledge. I do it every day on Twitter. When I'm having a writer's block, I'll come into Twitter, and that's when everybody's like, oh, get your pens and paper ready. She's ready. She's going to go with it. And I'll starting conversations and putting little nuggets out there. But it's general information that's still helpful. It's not giving you this is the 1, 2, 3 ABC of how you do it. So there are ways to still share and help people without giving away the farm. And that's where people have to learn how to differentiate the two. And I go through that in the book.
Yeah. Years ago, I was actually just thinking that years ago I used to I do a lot of speaking, but I would go to certain events and that were sort of community run or on conferences and speak there for free, obviously, because everybody did. And then I would get bombarded with questions. Mm-hmm. And I kind of started for a while, and I haven't done it lately, maybe because I haven't had the need to. Mm-hmm. I used to start my talks by saying, this is what I do professionally, blah, 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 and this is what I do in a philanthropic way back to my, you know, the social media community. And I said, I strive personally to try to do 25% of what I do. You know, I'm not like measuring it exactly, but 25% of what I do, I'd like to give back to the community. And that involves, you know, knowledge, helping, whatever have you. But 75% of it has to be for work, you know, for billing. But the 75% has to come first before I'll give you the 25%. Because if I'm not getting, you know, paying clients and such, then I just don't have the capacity for the free stuff. Mm-hmm. Is there any way that someone could kind of use as a litmus to know when they should start pushing back a little?
When someone comes in, and I've had that too, I've done conferences and speaking engagements where immediately after I'm bombarded with people lined up ready to ask me questions, if it's one general question or my opinion about something, I'll talk all day long. Don't have a problem with it. When you notice that they want to start asking follow-up questions, yeah, or they come to you with a specific issue, listen, my business is going through XYZ, that's a flag for you to know, okay, this can be a potential client. Let's sit down and set a consultation. And I tell people, use that word, consultation, not let's meet for lunch or coffee, because then they feel it's an open invite. But, okay, now you're coming into my professional territory. Let's set up some time for a consultation, and we'll see where we can go from there. And most times they'll call you. Sometimes they won't. They'll get a little offended that you said that. But you have to lay the groundwork. If you, as the consultant or the professional, don't lay it out in the beginning, you leave yourself open to be taken advantage of.
True. For me, the guilt is the worst part of it. I always feel like I should be helping these people, or I give too much and then there's no need for them to pay for the service. Mm-hmm. So I guess I'm kind of thinking out loud with that one. You said that whole, you know, use the word consultation, and I was like, wow, I just totally messed up last week. I had that opportunity. I had done a talk and I got what I call the stage crush.
Uh-huh.
Where everybody just comes at you, yeah. And you're like, I just need to go get a bottle of water.
Mm-hmm.
But the same thing. And I think that that's a really good flag to use, is if they start not speaking in general terms, like, yeah. Well, what's the best way to get started, or where's the best place to learn how to use X, Y, and Z? Those are pretty general terms.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if I had someone specifically that said, you know, I am in this industry, and this is the industry I came from, and I need to know how to bridge the two together, and how do I get in touch with those people? And I was just like, that's a little bit too much.
Yeah,
that's a consultation.
Uh-huh.
Consultation.
Because they want that, they're trying to ask you for a roadmap. You know, like I said, there's a distinct difference between someone who wants you to lay it all out and someone who just has a few questions. And the person doing the asking will argue tomato, tomato. But you have to be able to listen to those cues as the person that they're coming to know when and where to draw the line. And again, if you don't, you leave yourself wide open to be picked.
Pick. I agree. So let me ask you, was there anything that you found or discovered along the way of writing this book that kind of you could share with us that surprised you? That you're like, well, I really didn't think about taking it that way, or any kind of nugget that you...
Yes.
Gained along the way?
Yes. Actually, this is nothing to do with business owners. This is for job seekers. And it came out of a conversation that I had with one of my friends/clients. She became a client. And she brought up the subject of, you know, you're writing this book and you talk about brain picking consult. You know, you guys don't have it as bad as we do. And I said, well, what do you mean? She said, whenever we're going on a job interview, especially if it's a service type of position, and her position was like a social media manager. So, of course, because it's still kind of in its infancy, mm-hmm. and I hate when people say that, but it kind of is.
Yes.
People want to see, okay, well, if I had this campaign, what would you do? You know, walk me through. Mm-mm. And she said she did it, and I told her, I said, before she even finished the sentence, I said, you got taken, okay? As a recruiter, I know my boundaries and I know my limits of what to ask. And there are certain things that job candidates are not going to share because of fear of, well, if I give them this information, they won't hire me. They'll implement it themselves. And I've seen it done a lot of times by some ruthless, dirty Fortune 100 and Fortune 500 companies. And they call in, they set up this ad, and they say, well, we're looking for this, and they bring in these people who want to wow and impress the interviewer, so they start running at the mouth. And what I shared with her was, you could have set all of that aside and just gave them examples of previous success stories that you've had. You don't have to lay out, you know, you can tell them, I don't feel comfortable doing that because that would entail me having to do research and lay out a strategy. Mm-hmm. How about I share one of my previous experiences and show you how we walk through it and what the end result is? And I had no intentions of adding that component to the book, but it clicked and it made sense because I wanted the book to be appealing to not just business owners, but professionals as well, and especially in this job market when jobs are scarce and interviewers are taking advantage of unsuspecting job seekers.
You know, you said that, and I have to think that it may be more common in that social media consultancy role, because I've had people that have owned companies that were hiring, and while I don't do that, they'd be like, can you help me figure out what I need to look for when I hire someone? And, you know, that was paid, and that wasn't a big deal. But then they would come back to me, and they say, well, we got three different opinions from three different people, and those people, I think, were interviewees. And, you know, which one of these should I pick? Like, you know, they basically wanted to take the information and kind of mash it together and see if they could wing it themselves rather than, you know, pay $60,000 a year for the strategy, you know, for the strategist to come on board, and they thought maybe they can get away with it a little cheaper. But and it's that thing that it's that particular industry. It's knowledge based.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really seen as a tangible product. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of difficult.
Yeah, I mean, and that's just when there are many. I mean, in recruiting, there's some difference between a sourcer and a recruiter. The sourcer is the person that really gathers and finds the candidates and qualifies them. And I heard of a recruiter who would give these interviews and say, we need 10 software developers in Egypt. How would you find these people? Here's a list of the description that we need, the requirements that we need. I want you to go ahead and find 10 people. You can leave their names off, but find 10 people. And the lady that I had the conversation with, she said, I told them, no, I get paid $50 an hour to find people. I'm not going to give you this. And the recruiter couldn't understand why the lady had such an aversion to doing that. And I thought, this is very simple. You're asking her to do a job before she even has a job, and she's not getting paid for it. Yeah. So it's a little harder on the interviewer side to understand that, because I get it. They want to make sure they're hiring the best person. They want to make sure this person is knowledgeable. But anybody that you hire is a gamble. It's a gamble. You never know. And you can't expect somebody to lay out your entire company strategy for you just to get a job. So, and I think a lot of job seekers struggle with that.
Yeah, my husband's actually a software architect. Mm-hmm. And so in any of that really highly technical industry, I think they get that a lot too. I'm very familiar with I'm sure they don't appreciate being called it, but the headhunters. Mm-hmm. Which are the ones that are, you know, the sorcerers, I'm assuming that's mm-hmm. the equivalent, that it becomes a difficult struggle
Write this code for me, let me see what you got, and it's a tacky thing, but I think if job seekers learn how to handle themselves in those situations, they won't be, you know, the recipient of brain picking without getting the job. They'll show that they can figure a way, and I put it in the book, how to show your expertise, show what you bring to the table, and not give them everything so that they don't have to hire you.
Exactly. Okay, well, I'm kind of trying to check the other stream, because the thing about Google Plus Hangouts is I have to switch over to see. Yeah. There's no easy chat format in here for the general public. I want to see if there are other people that want to join into the Hangout. Okay. If you're okay with that, and we'll probably field some questions from them. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I'm going to see about, this is always the part that's a little wonky for me, because I have to invite people.
Okay. As long as they don't ask me to map out any strategy. Buy the book.
Let's see, I'm going to invite a couple people. So if you're watching and you've asked, I am going to first check quickly to make sure that you're not a crazy spammer, because there's always that, and see if I can ask somebody, get a couple people in here to join.
Okay. And I'm sure there are going to be some people that don't agree with me. That's okay. I'm fine with it.
There is. You know, the way that I kind of look at it, too, is if they want to, everyone is free to conduct their business how they'd like to. Mm-hmm. But like, just like when you said, when you wrote that post, sometimes you just need the right words or the light bulb to go off kind of thing to see. So I invited a couple. I don't know if they'll get notifications. I've never been on the other side of a live on-air hangout, I don't think.
I don't know
what they do over there, if they're going to get notifications or what, but I sent out a couple invites for this, so we'll see.
Yeah, I've only done private Google Hangouts, so I've never live streamed it before, so this is new.
Well, that's good. While we're waiting for if anybody else wants to pop in, sometimes they put in and they can't always stick around for the whole broadcast, mm-hmm. so... luckily, it gets streamed and saved directly up to YouTube, but I have to jump accounts.
Okay.
And then, because I prefer to have it listed on the Women of Google Plus YouTube account rather than my personal one. So it takes me about a day or two, and then I move them over, just so you know.
Okay. Well, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
How did you come up with the Women of Google Plus? Tell me, what was the brainchild behind that?
22 years of working in technology and one late night on Google Plus and a glass of wine. That's pretty much how it worked.
Okay.
Margie's coming in. So, hi Margie, how are you?
Oh, I'm fine. Hello, Adrienne. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. Is that your husband?
Finally made it to one hangout.
I'm the guy that makes the computer work out.
Yeah, Chris does.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
How are you?
You know, it's the woman's circle or whatever, not always. I'm fine, thank you. I definitely agree with you what you were talking about.
Yay!
I'm gonna put my headphones in.
I think I'm getting a little bit of feedback that's throwing me off a little bit.
Okay.
There we go. That's why I plugged my earphones in. I didn't want to mess anybody up.
Okay. Okay.
It might be. I don't know. You might need earphones as well. I don't know. Or headphones.
Should I put mine in as well?
If you have them, sure. You know what I've noticed? The more people get in, there's this lag and latency weird thing that happens, even though the software is supposed to compensate. I don't think it does 100%, so.
Is it not working?
I can hear it repeating, so. If you have earbuds, throw them in, ladies. That way the people that are watching this after the fact don't go completely insane by the echo.
Okay.
Is it on my end?
Mine.
So give me not sure where it is. Oh, that's fine.
Is it on my end?
If we get headphones in for both, it might work, and then we'll see where it is.
Actually, you know, when I realized that, New Year's Eve, my family was on Google Plus. We're all spread out.
Hold on. I'm going to get Chris. Haven't checked this out.
And everybody's countdown was delayed, so every 5 seconds, another person said, Happy New Year! And what happened? I'm going to put my earbuds in now.
Okay. I muted her out for the minute until Chris can come in and help her.
Okay. This is going to look weird, but I'm sure you'll edit.
Yeah, you know what the thing about Hangouts is, too, is everybody gets sort of... I mean, you get comfortable, you get casual.
Mm-hmm.
I'm used to doing communication online. It was very strange for me because I was always used to like either texting or voice online. Mm-hmm. And it's like makeup, yeah. Have to do it. I have a couple in the beginning. I have some really junky hat on and then makeup, and I got yelled at, but it's okay.
Yeah.
My publicist still loves me now, hopefully. So I have to ask, so what are your plans? You're going on tour for your first book.
Yes, I am. Can I show it?
Yes.
Okay. This is the book, Get Recruited. Oh, we lost Margie.
Ah, that's all right. She might jump back in.
Good. Well, yeah, the first book, well, it's not my first book, but that book was released the last week of November. It's done very well. It's been on Amazon. The digital version is on Amazon, and then the paperback is on my site. And we decided to just bring it to the streets. We have 10 cities lined up, Charlotte being the first city on the 25th, I think it is. And what we're going to do is kind of like, I didn't want to do a book signing. Those are so boring, and I don't do well sitting behind tables. I want to make it a conversation. I want to make it an interactive thing where we have like a group of people, a room full of people. I talk about the different strategies. They come in and they ask me their questions. We're going to bring a couple of people up on stage to give them kind of quick makeover thingies and make it happen. I mean, I don't want to talk at the people. I want to have the conversations, and I want to make sure they're equipped and, of course, have the book. So that way they can, you know, so it's kind of like a book signing slash...
like a little boot
seminar,
camp.
Seminar, kind of boot camp, kind of meet and greet. I'm sure there'll be some wine. So, yeah, it's going to be fun. It's going to be different.
Very nice. So do you have your dates publicized? Like, is it on your website?
I need it now.
Yes. It's on the website under events.
Okay, I'm going to look now because I'm not wearing my glasses now. Okay. So we're going to see. There it is.
Okay, under
so
about.
I want to read them. I found it. I'm like, wait, okay. I want to read them just so it shows up on the video so we know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of eyeballing. Yes, you're going to be in my area. I'm going. Okay, Charlotte, North Carolina on January 25th. Mm-hmm. Miami, Florida. You're going all over the place. January 28th. Tampa, Florida, February 4th.
Mm-hmm.
L.A., February 11th. San Diego, February 25th. Mm-hmm. New York, March 17th, I'll see you there.
Mm-hmm. That's my home.
That's the closest one to me. I'm a Jersey girl. I'm right in the middle.
Oh, okay.
Washington, D.C. Is March 31st. Chicago is January, February, March, April. I had to count it out. 7th, very smart because I heard they have like 100 feet of snow there right now.
Yes.
And then you're finishing up Dallas, Texas, which is March 28th. Does that come?
No. That's April 28th.
April
yeah.
28th.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
I'll change that. If that's a typo in there, I have to get in there.
No, it's not. It's just me not being able to count months.
Oh, okay.
That's amazing. And I see that you're doing other kind of webinars, live casts. You're just all over the place right now.
Yeah, I am. I have to keep it moving. Like I said, this new book kind of got thrown into the chink, but, you know, it's okay. My publicist, I said, you know, is that a little narcissistic? Can I do both? Well, she said, girl, please. She said, you can do both. So I want to see how the No, You Can't Pick My Brain book does, and if it does the way I think it's going to do, in the late spring, early summer, I'll set off another roadshow and do one for that book.
Please
I'm
come
sure
to
people
Phoenix.
Are talking about it. I should come where?
Phoenix.
Oh, absolutely. I have a cousin there with a big old house, so she told me I could stay with her.
Yeah, I know. I have to get
not too many shows come to Phoenix.
Okay. I have to get to Phoenix, too. It's always
can I jump in real quick, Lynette? I'm sorry to interrupt you. We had to leave you folks alone here in a minute. But I was just watching Piers Morgan be interviewed by Chelsea Handler on his own show.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sitting there in the living room thinking how, for marketers, that same show is going on here. And you folks are doing the equivalent of what they were doing on CNN very easily, very cheaply, and very effectively, and for marketers. And I absolutely love Chelsea Handler. She should be an awesome interviewer on her own. So I'll leave you folks. And,
okay.
See you in Phoenix, everybody.
I'll see you in Phoenix.
I know. I really do have to get out there.
Yeah.
Too funny. Yeah, so I went and I looked, and you've just got, there's so much information now in there. So empowerme.org is really where everyone needs to go to find out all your information.
Yes, empowerme.org. And if they want to catch my show, I have put it on hiatus. My show, Views from the Top, is on Blog Talk Radio. It's usually 9 o'clock a.m. Friday morning. Eastern Standard Time.
Eastern.
And what we've done was I've kind of stepped back. It was such a hectic schedule. I've stepped back, and I'm going to bring it back the first week of February, and we're going in a totally different direction. So everybody who's used to my raw kind of no-nonsense kind of thing, it's going to get amplified. So with some amazing guests.
Nice. Very nice. Very nice. It's funny. We actually have the I think Vic is a Gondoltra is a VP at Google, right?
Oh,
okay. He is, right? Vic, you're a VP. I forget. He's commenting on the stream too, so I guess he's watching as well.
Vic, I want my own on air if you're watching.
Yeah, we love you, Vic.
At Google.
Actually, I think Chi Chu is the. No, I know that he's the Hangouts. Product manager. I'm probably totally butchering that, but he's the Hangouts guy.
Good.
As far as I know, but I don't know their titles. I just know that they're always like on here and talking, and they're personable, and not for nothing, but I've never talked to anybody from the other blue and white website.
I'll say it. Facebook.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Facebook. I've never spoken to anybody from there. The Googlers, I totally love them. But I guess Vic's watching a bit because he just quoted something that we said. So.
Okay. I hope it was something good.
I think it had to do with wine, which I'm sadly missing. I think we should. I have to think of a way to rename this every Monday night that we can include wine. Because sometimes I'll have a glass here.
Yeah,
and people are like, oh, we could have brought wine. I'm like, unless you're driving in a car right now, you'd probably be all right.
Yeah.
All right, so Adrienne, what's next for you? What are you doing? Once you're like towards the end of the summer, once this all settles down for you, what do you want to do next? What inspires you to for your next project? I want to know.
Well, okay, my ultimate goal is to be on TV. If not, I don't want to be in front of the camera, but I think that there's a need for solutions-based TV. You know what? I'm launching an internet TV channel, so I'm kind of nervous about that. But and I've been on TV before, and I loved it, but I think a daily grind of being on TV would really do me in. But I want to executive produce or something. We need solutions, TV. I'm tired of this reality crap. We want to see how people are successful with their businesses, the trials and tribulations they go through, the job search, you know, the triumphs and the pitfalls. I want to see all that, and that's what I think America wants to see. And I have a couple of things in the works that I can't talk about, but I'm hoping that it'll turn into a TV project for me. Otherwise,
there's a really good network, I think, called OWN. That would probably be really good.
Yeah. Well, I'm just, she's listening. No, actually, I have said, I have been very vocal on Twitter, Facebook, all of that. I've sent letters and email, and I think that they're going to do what they want to do. I mean, I love Oprah. She's my number one role model, and much respect to her, but I don't think she's listening to what people really want. And my thing is, I'll push as much as I can, but between her and Sherry Salata, if you're watching, the president of her, I have really wanted to get in touch with them and just give them my ideas. And, you know, I don't need to be in front of the camera. I just want to see Solutions TV. I'm tired of this, you know, holistic, where's your mind and your spirit? That's beautiful, but people want solutions. So,
I agree. I have to, I agree with that. Marge, wouldn't you too?
Yeah, I do agree, and there's something I want to say too, and that is that, you know, what about, you know, the implementation, you know, with YouTube and all that stuff, you know, what's going on with Google TV, you know, I mean, virtually, you know, everybody, when once it catches on to the masses, you will be on Google TV, you will be on TV, you know, as people will be watching you, seeing all the value that you're giving to people, the benefits, you know, I mean, just listening to you two for these short few minutes, it's like, you know, what you were talking about earlier, what, when it comes to boundaries, you know, that's so important, and people need to learn that, not only on the side of the service, but also on the side of the people that need the service, because, you know, a lot of the stuff that we share, it's taken lots and lots of time and hours and connections and creating relationships and all that, et cetera. And I think that people, there's something that, you know, when you Google search, oh, I could just search that, blah, blah, blah. But if you really got down to looking for everything, it would take you a long time.
Yeah.
And not only that, you have people such as you, Lynette, and you, Adrienne, where you have that expertise, that experience, and you can hone in on each individual and help them implement their steps to get further along their way. And you're right, Lynette, when it comes to, you know, I can give you and offer you the knowledge and teach you and all that, but it's up to you for the action.
Yeah.
It's up to you. So, anyway, that's my spiel.
No, good. I like that. And actually, you know what? And as I'm sitting here listening to you guys, I would love to take this new book and do like an Oprah Life class kind of thing, and not to copy or anything. Kind of the copy. But I would love to do that because there are so many people, you know, like Lynette and I were saying, that still just don't know how to draw those boundaries. They don't know how to get it. And for me, the webinars and the seminars and the classes, everybody's doing it, but I want to do something different. I think Oprah really trailblazed when she did Life Class. So, I mean, I don't have a bunch of footage to kind of go behind it, but I think that the book on its own, the topic itself is such a highly discussed topic that I could do something like that. So, if anybody from OWN is listening, I'm totally not OWN.
Let's just put it that way. I'm just me on Google Plus. But, Adrienne, I promised you in the beginning that I would totally not put you on the spot.
Oh, no.
But I'm doing it now. All right. You don't have to answer. I'm just saying. I'm going to ask you for future consideration.
Okay.
That maybe when your 10-city tour is over and you've gone out and you've promoted your book and you've done mini boot camps, maybe we can do something like that virtually here.
Absolutely.
With on air, and we'll get you and I, and then I could fit 8 others, and it can all be streamed, and we can do a mini version of what you were doing on your book tour, maybe.
Absolutely. With some wine.
With some wine.
Yes, I would love it.
Wow, I wonder if we could do like a virtual book tour. That would be awesome.
Oh, that is awesome.
It would be. You know, and I thought about it, and I was, there was, I can't remember the young lady who did the live concert.
Yes, and I watched her video.
Amazing. And it gave me the idea, because there are a lot of people say, you're not coming to my city. And I'm like, okay, let me see. And I had it in the back of my mind to do for the Get Recruited book, to do a book tour like that. But I would so totally do this for the new book. Yeah.
Okay, good. No, I don't feel so bad about putting you on the spot.
No.
Okay. Well, I've wrapped up your time for an hour, and I'm very surprised that I managed to keep it to an hour. So with that, I guess we'll wrap up, and I want to let everyone know again that this recording, once I bring it down and do magic on it, and I will be putting it back up on the Women of Google Plus YouTube stream on the channel, and I will have all of Adrienne's links for her book, for her speaking tour, you know, for her engagements for her book, everything that I could find about Adrienne that I could possibly put in there, so that you can see her, you can get her book, everything. I'll put it there for her. And if you have any more questions, definitely circle Adrienne in Google Plus. You could, if you're watching this video, if you go to that stream, then you'll be able to see her name there, and you could just click on her plus name and go and circle her there. Follow her. I think she's brilliant.
Thank you.
That article that you wrote alone just filled my brain with so many things. I cannot wait for your book to come out.
Thank you.
I will be like Kindle order number 2, probably. After you. I'll be looking for 2. So I want to thank you again. Is there anything else that we need to know before we go? Or
The only thing I would say is I'm approachable, and I just ask that people, you know, I laugh, I joke, I people know my personality, like on Twitter or whatever. What you see on Twitter is what you see in person. I'm an easy person to get to know. I'm not a yes person. I mean, I'm open. If you have a disagreement, if you don't agree with the book or the article, I'm fine with that. Let's just be respectful about it and just agree to disagree. That's the type of person I am. I mean, I'm pretty easygoing, except when people try to buy my knowledge with a turkey sandwich.
No. Very good. And your Twitter handle is, I know the one is Talent Diva, Talent Diva. So
Talent
Diva. Put on that, right? So if you're watching right now and you jump over to the other network, go follow her. So when I end this, it ends broadcast, and we all say goodbye to each other, because that's how technology works. So I will catch up with both of you and all of the watchers or listeners. That's kind of strange. They're watchers. Seems a little strange. They're watchers.
Viewers.
Viewers. Yeah, that's the right word. I'm like listeners. I'm still tuned into being a podcast. So we'll make sure everybody gets that. Leave answers or questions in the thread here, and we'll have myself and Adrienne check in on it every once in a while, just to see, make sure people's questions got answered, and that's it.
Yeah.
So thank you all very much. Thank you very, very, very much, Adrienne, for agreeing to come in. And thanks, Marge, for coming in on us today.
It was
wonderful
listening to you both. It was great information.
Thank you. Oh, and I answer everyone. I do. It takes a while, but I respond to everybody.
Good. Yes. You're very personable. You're not like, I'm so good. You're not really like, you know, the diva. You're not very diva-ish for being a talent diva. I'm pretty disappointed, actually.
I guess. Humble diva.
Okay, so that's it for our interview today. We have Women of Google Plus and Professional Women of Google Plus have a video hangout every Monday, with the exception of a couple. Sometimes I have speaking engagements or things that I need to attend to. But next week we're having the amazing Jane Ellen is going to come in and do talks with us, and she is going to help us get through doing video hangouts. Pretty much. She has amazing tips for us to present ourselves with our best face or best foot forward using video hangouts. So that's what's on deck for next week. And if anyone ever has suggestions for amazing speakers, talks, interviewees, pass it our way. I'm pretty good about finding amazing people on my own, but I'm always looking for suggestions. All right. Take care, everyone. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.